Good morning and welcome to the third meeting of 2022 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. Today's meeting is being held virtually. Our first item of business is a decision to take items 6 and 7 in private. Are members content to do so? Our next item of business this morning is the final evidence session on our inquiry into Scotland's supply chains. We are looking at the short and medium term structural challenges facing Scotland's supply chains, and how the challenges and shifts in supply chains are impacting on Scotland's economy. We are also aware of a number of longer term challenges that need to be addressed too. We want to consider how to build future resilience and whether there are opportunities to develop domestic supply chains within Scotland. The committee have structured the inquiry around the themes of people, places and product, and we are looking to explore these issues with the Minister and his team this morning. Can I thank our witnesses for joining us today and welcome Ivan McKee, Minister for Business, Trade, Tourism and Enterprise, David Barnes, Interim Deputy Director, Trade Policy, George Burgess, Deputy Director, Food and Drink, Lewis Hedge, Interim Deputy Director, Fair Work and Labour Market Strategy, and Dermot Rattigan, Deputy Director for Manufacturing and Industries, all from the Scottish Government. As always, can I ask members and witnesses to keep questions and answers as concise as possible, and I start by inviting the Minister to make a short opening statement.
Good morning, Convener and Committee, and thank you very much for the invitation to join you this morning, and you've already introduced the officials who are with me this morning. Scotland, as you know, is part of a global economy, and international trade is an important mechanism through which we can enhance our place in the world and build diversity in our supply chains. Recent events, of course, including Brexit, COVID, the blockage of the Suez Canal and other challenges have exposed vulnerabilities in our supply chains, and Scotland's remote communities in particular often suffer disproportionately through being at the end of long supply chains or indeed requiring smaller volumes of products. And this has been a challenging time for many businesses, but we have also witnessed tremendous resilience and ingenuity. Supply chain shortages have accelerated change, created new opportunities for some Scottish firms and prompted innovative solutions. Perhaps the clearest example was the sourcing of vital NHS supplies such as PPE throughout the pandemic. We witnessed companies diversifying from producing whisky to producing hand sanitizer, electronics firms repurposing production lines, and subsea specialists turning to making ventilators in previously unimaginable timescales. Pre-pandemic, all of our PPE was sourced from abroad. Now, with the exception of gloves, the vast majority is manufactured here in Scotland. And some firms have gone on to develop innovative new products that are being sold to the rest of the world. Alpha Solway, for example, a Dumfries-based company, recently developed one of only a handful of UK-approved transparent masks available on the market today. Demand for this product has extended to overseas, with recent orders placed to export millions of these masks to clients in the European Union, with additional opportunities emerging. We will continue to maximise supply chain opportunities from public sector procurement. Under investment in economic assets such as the National Manufacturing Institute Scotland, their innovation centres, the Scottish Manufacturing Advisory Service and others will support manufacturers to adapt to changes and constraints in the supply of materials and components. In addition, I have a programme of work ongoing with port and airport operators and others to determine the scope for Scotland to export more of our products directly, thus increasing resilience and reducing our carbon footprint. In its sessions so far, the committee has highlighted that the labour market has tightened and vacancies have increased. We are working with business organisations to develop a Working with Businesses Action Plan focused on employability skills, fair work principles, to identify actions to mitigate the impact of labour shortages. We are investing more than £1 billion this year to drive forward our national ambition for jobs and an additional £500 million this Parliament to support new jobs and reskill people for the good, fair and green jobs of the future. And we continue to call on the UK Government to make changes to the immigration system to combat post-EU exit skills and labour shortages. Our new 10-year National Strategy for Economic Transformation will have a focus on developing the skills Scotland's future workforce needs and maximising the use of Scottish manufactured components in areas of new market opportunity. Robust and resilient supply chains are the bedrock of a thriving economy, and I'm clear that we need to take every opportunity to strengthen Scotland's supply chains. And I very much look forward to our discussion this morning. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Minister. I'd like to start by asking a couple of questions around the issue of people and skills in the labour market, which you referred to at the end of your statement. Often when people think about supply chains, they focus on products and commodities. And what we found in the earlier sessions taking evidence was that people and skills were where a lot of the gaps were that were putting real pressure on businesses. They might be able to get the product. It was the issues with logistics of actually getting it here. One of the issues that we raised with Skills Development Scotland and Open University was about inactivity within the labour market. One of the reasons for that could be a consequence of the pandemic, but they did identify people who are furthest away from the labour market or people who would be lacking the right skills to get into the labour market. Now, Audit Scotland published a report in the last couple of weeks that has been quite critical of the way in which our skills service is delivered. And places some real challenges for the government and for Skills Development Scotland and for Ecology Scotland. Could you comment on the Audit Scotland report and how you will respond to the issues that are raised within it when it comes to trying to address some of the labour shortages and pressures we see within our supply chain structures?
With regards to the issue of labour market and activity, you're right. 22% of Scotland's working age population, so between 16 and 24, that aren't active. Now, that's about 750,000 people there or thereabouts. It's a number that's broadly similar to the rest of the UK. And when you delve into that and have a look, there's a number of reasons for that. Some of them very valid reasons to do with people in education, childcare responsibilities, ill health, and other reasons. But what we have undertaken is a programme, and we'll be talking more about this in our national strategy, to really understand more about that and address it, because it's becoming increasingly clear that with the access to international labour through Brexit and so on and so forth being challenged, we need to focus much more on how we tackle that labour market inactivity issue. So, for example, some of that will come down to the expansion of childcare that we're undertaking that enables parents to get back to work earlier where they choose to do so. Some of it's to do with transport links and our strategic transport review that came out recently addresses some of those issues to enable people to get economic opportunities. Some of it will be to increase skills and make people, in some cases, at first in the labour market, more aware of the opportunities and people that have been out of work for a long time to help smooth their transition back into work. So there's a whole plethora of different aspects of that that we're focused on, and it's an increasingly an issue that we need to address, not only because it's the right thing for those individuals, but also because it's an issue increasingly of support for businesses and having access to the labour pool that is available within Scotland. With regard to the Audit Scotland report, I mean, is there any specific aspects of that that you wanted me to address?
I mean, I do appreciate you're not the lead minister on the skills agenda, and it does talk more to the skills agenda. But there were, I think, concerns expressed about the issues around the ability of the sector to deliver for people that really need it, and to be properly coordinated with what businesses need, and for a working relationship between Skills Development Scotland and Ecology Scotland, I think, to be improved.
I think there's lots of bits of this that need to be joined up, but also it's to a large extent, and you'll have heard this from some of your witnesses in earlier sessions, it really very much is a moving target as well. You've got trying to predict what the skill shortages are going to be years ahead is obviously notoriously difficult. So it's a combination of increasingly closer alignment between the skills system and businesses. And it's about having that right mix of practical skills that we know are going to be required, but also ensuring that young people, but those right through their whole career, are equipped with the ability to be able to reskill and understand the opportunities that are there and what support they can get for that throughout their career. So there's, as I said at the start, spending more than £1 billion supporting the skills system, an extra £500 million on top of that over the course of the Parliament to focus on that. But I talk to businesses every week, every day, and not skills is the number one issue. I mean, everything else is going on, notwithstanding, it's always skills that's the top issue. We're hugely seized of the need to focus on that, and I suppose it's, as I said, it's about making sure that the skill system is increasingly aligned with the needs of business. We've got those clear routes of communication so we can make sure that there's an understanding of what's required, but also, as I say, the system needs to be very agile because it's such a moving target.
Thank you. We also took evidence on the Logan review, which is then about digital skills gap, which, you know, if you're speaking to businesses, you'll know that's one of the big issues. So while it's about people who are far away from the labour market and need entry into the labour market, there are also those who are currently in the labour market who need to improve their skills and have access to the skills that we need in the modern age, and the digital skills gap is one of the key areas. Can I ask, is there a timeline for do you know if there's a timeline for the implementation of Logan Review's recommendations? And
well, it's ongoing. And so there's lots. I can't remember the number, but there's dozens of aspects to that across the education system. Some of that about doing more computer science teaching in schools is obviously going to take time because you need to make sure you've got the resource in terms of teachers that are able to deliver those courses. And that was something that Mark obviously raised in his report, that of itself is a challenge. You need to deal with that. Then you need to roll that out across the school curriculum, which it's hugely important. And coming from a STEM background myself, I absolutely understand that the criticality of that. Other aspects of it, like the rollout of the tech scalers, is something that's ongoing. So I think there's different timescales across different recommendations and action points that are in the report. And Mark, to his credit, has kept on the pressure because something like this, we're asking government and the system to do things different to how we've done them before. That's something I'm very keen that the government is able to be more agile, to be more responsive, and be able to execute on initiatives like the work that Mark's undertaken, we continue to push to move that along as fast as possible. We're on the right track there, and as I say, there's a different range of timescales depending on the specific recommendations. It's also worth reflecting, the report will come out shortly, the strategy for economic transformation, and it really builds on the work of the Logan report and extends that to other parts of the economy, other sectors, and broadens it out as well, round about the approach to tech scalers, supporting those growth businesses, but also very much the skills aspect of that, and making sure that people early stage career and mid career are able to retrain to be able to support tech, coding skills, digital skills in all shapes and sizes, but also broadening it out to wider requirements of the new industries we're developing in Scotland.
Thank you. The committee is looking forward to the publication of the 10-year strategy. We had hoped to see it before Christmas, but I do appreciate it's been delayed, and it's welcome that the Logan Review will be, you're suggesting it will be integral to the 10-year strategy once it arrives. I'm now going to hand over to Maggie Chapman, who's got questions in a similar area, and she'll be followed by Colin Beattie.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning, Minister. Thank you for being here this morning, and thank you for your opening remarks and comments you've already given us. As the Convener said, just extending the discussion a little bit around labour and the gaps and skills and training. You said yourself, you know, it's difficult to forecast, to predict where some of the gaps are going to be, but there are very clear instances where we know exactly what is needed, what should be needed, and what will be needed. So there are some circumstances where we have identified the problem quite clearly, and the digital skills gap that you've already talked about is one of them. But I suppose we already know from the construction industry that in order to meet their net zero targets, they're going to need 22,500 additional members in their labour force in the next few years. And we know in the just transition to away from hydrocarbons, whether that's in energy, whether it's in other sectors, there are significant requirements for agility and flexibility. Can I ask, I suppose, a couple of questions? How, for construction, how can we ensure that we meet the needs of the additional workforce numbers required? And for the just transition, how can we make sure that uptake of the skills and training opportunities that we are planning for and are currently in training, how can we make sure that uptake is effective to deliver the kinds of changes we need?
Yeah, good questions. I think the first point to reflect on is in the question itself, when you talk about we know where the gaps are. Now, it's one thing to say is construction needs 22,000 people, but then what are those skills? And clearly, there's a wide range of different skills that are used on a construction site. But also, when you look at the trends within that sector, we're doing a lot of work at the moment on developing capacity and capability and innovation around about off-site manufacturing. So that moves a lot of construction work in modular form into a factory setting, which then is a different type of skill sets that you require there. And clearly, with the shift in materials as a consequence of shortages, but also as a consequence of the transition to net zero, with more timber structure, different types of timber structures, etc., coming in play, the types of skills that are required to support that again change. So that thing is evolving over time, but it's important that we stay close to it. And likewise on digital, we talk about digital skills, but coding languages evolve every year or two. I'm not an expert in that area, but when you look at those requirements, somebody that trained 10 years ago in coding, their skills are a large extent out of date already, even 5 years ago. So upgrading those and understanding what the new coding requirements are is important. And then that's again different from broad-based digital skills, where people who don't do digital all the time, but they need to know how to work a spreadsheet, or they need to know how other digital connectivity skills is required. So there's a whole range of different things even within those broad buckets, and it's really important to understand that. But in terms of how do you get people to take advantage of those, you're right, there's going to be a whole range in there. So there's some people who will be very hungry to be able to take part in that. They'll see it as advancement, they'll see it as an opportunity to up their income and being a sector that's more advantageous for them going forward. Others, you need to make them aware of what those opportunities are, and that extends right through the whole piece. So there needs to be closer engagement between business and schools, frankly, so that people, young people coming through, understand what those opportunities are and are able to set their sights on how their choice of subjects and how their choice of further and higher education reflects the types of careers and opportunities that are there, and how they take advantage of those. And likewise, mid-career, and that will be in people have decided to reskill, and again, some great initiatives on coding training that are out there, and we'll look to develop that, or people who are unfortunately facing a redundancy situation, and the PACE initiative is there to support that. And it's again, I think there's a huge priority there about making people aware of the different retraining opportunities that exist. And then I talked about labour market and activity, so as we get closer to that, people that are out for health reasons but are able to work perhaps part-time or perhaps in certain employments, how do we make sure that they have got a focus on the types of skills they need, and people are returning to the labour market after having a family to meet them awareness of what's there. So you're dealing with hundreds of thousands of people. The training programmes are there, as I said, a significant amount of funding going in from Scottish Government, but you're absolutely right, joining that up and making sure the provision that's there reflects what business needs now and in the future, and that people are aware of that is something we're constantly focused on.
Thank you very much. That's really helpful. Can I just dig a little deeper? In your opening remarks, you talked about the shift, or the diversification that so many companies and businesses have done to provide the things that we needed during the pandemic. And I'm wondering, obviously, a lot of that was driven, there were financial incentives for them to do that. There was also the moral imperative. And I think many of us would argue that there are similar imperatives around just transition. And you said there that, you know, some people who choose to reskill and retrain, perhaps particularly in energy, away from hydrocarbon energy intensive industries. Is there a role not only for the funding and support of the training and reskilling and the courses to enable people to to get the skills for the future economy. But is there something around incentivizing people so it makes that choice easier? And I think there is something about the labour market workers actually feeling that they have no choice, that they have no power in all of this. And is there something that we can be thinking about and implementing to support people? Because, you know, we talk about the labour market, we talk about the workforce as an amorphic thing, but they're people, they're members of communities, they're individuals with hopes and dreams. And I think that often gets lost in some of the planning and sometimes even the implementation. So how do we bridge that gap?
Yeah, you're right. And I think it's about digging a bit deeper and understanding what's going on there. And if you look at energy, for example, energy isn't a scenario where you've got fossil fuel production and on one side and you've got renewables on the other, and they're completely different things, they're completely divorced from each other. They're not. The businesses that are involved in one are almost always involved in both. The newer businesses and renewables are specifically focused on some, new technologies aren't, but the legacy businesses that are in fossil fuels are transitioning, and pretty much every single business in that sector is on that journey, and they are reskilling their workforce as they make that move. And a lot of the skills are very transferable very quickly. A lot of the offshore skills, for example, deep water skills, are very transferable from oil and gas platforms to looking offshore wind and so on. So a lot of that will happen as the opportunities, it'll be kind of pulled from the opportunity side as we move the production over to renewable energy. There are other areas where there's a bigger gap in terms of the skills that you need to acquire to do that. I think it's fair to say that, I mean, this has got huge profit, right? You turn the television, the radio, and we're talking about these issues, particularly on the back of COP. So people are aware of that, and I think people are making those decisions on where they want to have their career. Younger people, in particular, ironically, one of the comments you get from oil and gas production is that young people don't want to go and work for them anymore, which is perfectly understandable because they're focused on net zero. They understand the climate emergency and they want to be in the sectors of the future. So I think there is that there's that pull from the technology as things move over. There is that push from people at all stages in their careers wanting to be in the sectors of the future. Our job is obviously to provide the bridge that allows them to have those training opportunities. But it's not just us, the private sector businesses are hugely invested in this. We work closely with them and they are doing a lot of the heavy lifting on this because it's in their interest, obviously, but also from our point of view, it's the right thing for them to do that. So have we got everything absolutely perfect? No, of course not, but I think there's an awful lot happening that's moving this increasingly in the right direction.
Thanks very much. Thank you, convener. That's me.
And thank you. I'll now bring in Colin Beattie to be followed by Alexander Burney.
Thank you, convener. Minister, Scotland is facing quite an acute demographic challenge, perhaps even compared to the rest of the UK. Inward migration over a number of years has been the key driver of population growth. Do we have any levers in the Scottish Government to attract the necessary inward migration to help reduce labour shortages? And has there been discussions with the UK Government on Scotland's particular issues there?
We do have some levers, but clearly there are many levers we don't have. So I'll talk briefly on the ones we don't have and then talk about the ones we do have. So clearly we don't have control over immigration powers internationally, and that's something that we've constantly asked the UK government to be more flexible on, both in terms of what they're doing with the restrictions that they have, ridiculous restrictions they have on labour coming from abroad, but also to devolve more of those immigration powers. And you look at countries like Australia, Canada, which have a degree of devolution of immigration powers. So it's a model that works perfectly well, and there's no reason not to do it. And clearly, we would want to be back in the single market, and that is our ambition to deliver on that, the European single market, which resolves many of those issues. But in terms of the levers we have got to pull, there are things that we can do about, as I've mentioned, labour market and activity, and how we bring more people into the labour market that way, but also what we can do to focus on immigration from the rest of the UK into Scotland. Now, at the moment, there is a net inward immigration from the rest of the UK. There's about 30,000 people leave Scotland every year on average, and about 40, 41,000 come into Scotland from the rest of the UK. That's a net positive. That's something that we are increasingly focused on maximising, tackle many of those specific skill challenges. I've got a programme underway working with businesses and others in the sector to understand how we can target that more effectively, how we can get that message out there, how we can work to increase the net inward immigration from the rest of the UK into Scotland, and that's a programme I think that's going to get increasing focus on it, because it is one of the few things that we can do, levers we can pull as Scottish Government, given that we don't have control over international immigration powers.
We hear a great deal about the number of skilled migrants who came to us from Europe while we're still a member of the EU, and how so many of them have returned to the EU. And particularly we hear of areas like social care, construction and so on, where we do have shortages, and that potentially been exacerbated by that. Do we actually have any sort of idea, firm idea, of the actual impact of Brexit on the skill shortages that we're facing at the moment?
Well, it's been significant. Right now, part of the issue has been unpicking that from the COVID situation is difficult, because if somebody leaves to return home, then you don't know if that is because they've got personal reasons or other reasons why they want to be back in their country of origin to deal with that, and then the situation where it makes it much harder for them to move back and forward. Whether they've got family commitments in Poland or whatever, then obviously COVID made that much, much more difficult, and people may choose as a consequence to stay back in their country of origin. But without a doubt, obviously Brexit's made a huge difference, and as COVID restrictions subside and international travel opens up again in normal times, we would then expect that labour market to free up, but clearly Brexit stops that happening. So, and the messaging is hugely important. The UK government's hostile approach to immigration and to immigrants is very, very difficult, because, and we saw this with the HGV drivers, the message the UK government was sending out was just ridiculous, counterproductive and really unhelpful in terms of, we expect these people to drop everything, change their lives, come and help us when we need it, and then we won't allow them to come in for a short period of time. So of course it's not going to work. So Brexit's had a huge impact, and as we move beyond COVID, it'll become increasingly obvious that that's a huge break on Scotland's economic potential.
Just to continue on the question of Brexit, new restrictions on imported products from the EU came into effect on 1st January. Do you have any sense as to the impact that this is having on Scottish businesses? I know it's early days, but perhaps there's some early indications.
It's just another barrier. It just makes life difficult, makes business difficult. It just makes things harder that shouldn't be that hard. And it makes it uncertain as well, because there's clearly paperwork requirements. There's all kinds of clearances that are required, and different rules and regulations around about that, that just puts red tape in the way of businesses. That's really unhelpful and just clogs up supply chains and eats away at the capacity and the agility of businesses to respond as they should. So it's hugely unhelpful. And as you said, those further restrictions have just come in. Too early to say specifically the impact of them. But it's another example of UK government placing ideology above the needs of business.
Is there anything that the Scottish Government can do to ease any of these restrictions that have been brought in, or is it completely out of the control of the Scottish Government?
Well, in terms of those rules, we continue to pressure the UK government to change them, but that obviously is a reserved area. What we can do, of course, and I've talked about what we did in PPE and elsewhere, and we continue to do an awful lot of work through our supply chain development programmes and other activities, is to look for opportunities to manufacture more of those products within Scotland to create economic opportunities here, and also to build resilience. So that is, I would say, in terms of the work we're doing, the primary lever we've got to be able to tackle that. But clearly, there are many, many things that you can't manufacture here in a way that's competitive. There are many that we can, but clearly we can't do it for everything. So that is part of the answer, but it's obviously not the whole answer.
Given the impact of Brexit on the supply chains, do you think that there is a way where the Scottish Government can build more resilience into the Scottish end of the supply chain, realising that, you know, there's a limit to how far we can go, that would just in some way mitigate the impact of Brexit in any way? Or is that just so totally out of our control that what we can do is marginal?
Well, what we can do is, as I said, it's not the whole answer. It's marginal in the sense that it allows us to tackle some of these issues at the margins, but obviously doesn't allow us to tackle the key issues round about barriers to international trade, which is hugely unhelpful. As I said, the work we're doing, we'll be talking more about it, to facilitate more and support more manufacture of products in Scotland is a part of that. But as you rightly said, the Brexit restrictions make this very difficult for supply chains, for businesses and for Scotland's economy and consumers.
In endeavouring to put in place the measures that you're talking about there, Minister, surely the skills shortages that apparently have arisen largely as a part of Brexit are going to constrain how far we can go in encouraging manufacturing and so on in Scotland. Because
that will depend sector by sector, opportunity by opportunity, but where there is, for example, in some advanced engineering, life science sector, some other sectors where we've got opportunities to manufacture more in Scotland, the shortage of those kind of specific skills that would normally have come from an international labour pool is absolutely a key issue. And then in other parts of the economy, for example, in agriculture or in food processing or other sectors that relied on significant numbers of migrant workers, then that is clearly put up a significant break on those sectors, and likewise on hospitality, leisure, tourism, and other sectors within the Scottish economy that are suffering as a consequence of Brexit and the restriction on labour migration.
Thank you, Minister. Back to you, Convener.
Thank you. I will bring in Alexander Burnett, be followed by Colin Smith, but I think Alexander Burnett will follow some of these issues because I share the Minister's concerns and the concerns about what situation we're in post leaving the EU. But this is the new reality. We need the Scottish economy to respond to that. So I think the questions around skills and around a sustainable and resilient supply chain are issues that we'd like to have a focus on. But I'll hand over to Alexander Burnett, followed by Colin Smith.
Yeah, thank you very much, Convener. And yes, to follow on, three questions on labour supply and investment to attract labour. Now, the Finance Committee, chaired by your colleague Kenny Gibson, is saying the evidence of Scotland's economic underperformance is deeply worrying. We've got higher rates of economic inactivity than elsewhere in the UK across all areas, such as skills gap, lifestyle choices, and lower life expectancy, leading to earlier retirement. So can I ask, what are you specifically doing to reduce such inactivity and increase our domestic labour supply?
Yeah, I mean, there is a gap. The gap isn't as big as you're making out. From memory, I think we're at 22%. The rest of the UK is at about 21% labour market activity. So, yeah, there are differences, but they're not hugely significant. We are, as I said at the beginning, our earlier question, are focused on understanding the makeup of that 750,000 people. Some of them are in that situation for good reasons, because they're in education, they are suffering from ill health, they are taking care of families, but it's understanding on the margin what you can do to reduce that total number. I mean, even obviously 100,000 of those 750,000 people, for example, to pick a number random or back in the labour market, then it would be very helpful to the situation we find ourselves in. So for every part of that cohort, if you like, there's going to be a different answer. For parents that are returning after childcare, then clearly childcare provision is important. So the expansion of childcare, a few childcare hours, is hugely important there. In some situations in rural, but also in cities as well, there's issues around about transport and accessibility to enable people to get to economic opportunities. And again, that's something government's hugely focused on addressing. In situations where the issue is ill health, then clearly there may be, as I said earlier, opportunities that some individuals can take up with support and with training that they might not otherwise have been able to and be part of the labour market, which is great for them and great for the economy as well. So, and then again, you look at students. And one of the interesting differences in the UK and the rest of the UK and Scotland has been about the number of students in that labour market and activity pool and work. We're exploring that a bit further to understand reasons for that. But again, that's a double-edged sword because do you want students in the labour market when perhaps they should focus more on their studies? So there's a balance to be struck there. So we are increasingly deeply involved in understanding those issues and driving forward programmes to address each of them separately because the answers each cohort are very, very different.
Thank you. The committee report also talks of longer-term low productivity and poor business investment. Yeah, and the latest blow to develop a manufacturing supply chain is the opposition to civil nuclear energy, with Rolls-Royce's SMR consortium looking everywhere for its 200 million factory, except in Scotland. So there's a problem. Does the minister recognise his own government's policies or his own levers, to put it in a phrase, are a problem for attracting inward migration to reduce labour shortages?
Inward migration or inward investment?
Both, I think. I think in migration, the labour would follow investment. So if companies were investing in factories,
I've already said Scotland attracts significantly more people from the rest of the UK than leave Scotland to go to live in the rest of the UK, so we have a net a positive migration from the rest of the UK. So if it was a question of attractiveness, then on that measure, Scotland is significantly more attractive than the rest of the UK because we attract significantly more people from the rest of the UK than leave Scotland to go to the rest of the UK, and that gap is widening. In terms of inward investment, likewise, Scotland has consistently outperformed every other part of the UK outside of London in terms of attracting inward investment over the last 7 years in a row now. We've outperformed every other part of the UK outside of London. When it comes to R&D investment, Scotland even outperforms London on the latest data. And if you look at the data for last year, which was clearly the year of COVID, Scotland's inward investment increased by 5%. The UK's inward investment was down -12%. The EU was -13%. So everywhere else in Europe was going down, Scotland's inward investment it was going up. Scotland is a very attractive place for inward investment. Our inward investment plan is hugely focused on increasing Scotland's attractiveness for inward investors. We've got more work to do there, but we're in a much better place than many parts of the rest of the UK when it comes to attracting inward investment.
Thank you, and I hope we'd all want to see a continued increase in migration from the rest of the UK. But you mentioned putting ideology above the needs of business, but we've now got a First Minister looking to bring forward legislation for another referendum. I just wonder, after all the lessons learned over the last year, 8 years, on the economic effects of referendums on the economy, in what parallel universe does the Minister think this uncertainty is going to attract people and investment, particularly when the rest of the world is focused on post-COVID recovery?
Well, the rest of the world is focused on a lot of things, and it's about exploiting the opportunities that exist. And Scotland is extremely well placed in many of those sectors of the future, be it renewable energy, be it life science, be it our space sector, be it fintech and our financial services sector, be it across a whole range of advanced manufacturing opportunities, be it our food and drink innovation, and so on and so forth. So Scotland is extremely well placed to take advantage of those opportunities, and the things that are stopping Scotland, as we've highlighted already in the questions, is not having access to the large EU market, both export and import, because of the restrictions of Brexit, not having access to the labour market that's out there to fuel our growth, and not having the ability to tailor immigration programmes, and more broadly than that, not having control over the full welfare of leavers, which would allow us to tailor that both to support people and tackle poverty, but also to smooth the transition back into work when the UK welfare system mitigates against that in so many cases. And I could go on and on and on. So the things that hold Scotland back are not having those levers, not being a normal, independent country that can take its own decisions, not despite having a suite of advantages, the most highly educated population in Europe at tertiary level, despite all of those advantages, not being able to maximise those opportunities, not being as well off as our colleagues in Denmark, Norway, Sweden, Finland, Switzerland and elsewhere, who are normal independent countries of Scotland size, with far less opportunities than us, that do much, much better than us. The reason Scotland held back is the union, and the sooner we're out of it, the better.
Thank you, Minister. Thank you, Mr. Burnett. I will now make some progress. Could I remind members the subject of this morning's session is supply chains, the inquiry we've been working on for the past few months, and the Minister is here to ask questions in that area. I do appreciate people might want to expand into other areas, but we have a limited time this morning, and I would ask the members could focus on the issue at hand. I'll hand over to Colin Smith to be followed by Michelle Thompson.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to the Minister. Minister, the committee has heard a number of concerns about the current procurement regime, claims that it's very focused on price, it doesn't properly measure the environmental benefit of using local products, and also the use of local firms is largely ignored in any scoring process. It's really just about encouraging local firms rather than making it a requirement in contracts. And it also, the process doesn't encourage the use of alternative products and materials, which could encourage the growth of our supply chain in Scotland. So do you recognise these concerns from businesses, and is any consideration being given to fully reforming the procurement process to better prioritise local companies?
It's a bit of a leading question. We're very much on a journey there, and progress, significant progress has been made in a number of areas that I'll talk through. But I do recognise that there's absolutely more we can do, and I'm relentless in my engagement with the procurement officials within Scottish Government and wider across the public sector, and looking for every opportunity to move forward in all of those areas. The sustainable procurement requirements and legislation are hugely important, and they focus procurement on making sure that we've got community benefit, local aspects to procurement as part of the requirement. The situation is far from being that we only go on price. There's a whole range of factors that are considered. And in actual fact, we're in a position of where only choosing on price is not an option. In public sector procurement, you need to look at a wider range of factors, including, as I said, local issues, sustainability, SMEs, and a whole range of other factors as part of those decision-making processes. So we've moved a long way from it only being about price, but there is more to do. You've also got to remember that we don't have free rein on this for good reasons. We're part of the GPA, WTO, GPA, where requirements to have a situation where if Scottish businesses go and try and export, they would expect the debt not to be stacked against them in international markets. And likewise, we have to have an open and fair, transparent process for competition within procurement in Scotland. But what we can do is set the criteria as best we can within the rules available internationally, be able to support that. And if you look at the results, the percentage of public sector business that SMEs in Scotland win is far higher than that in the rest of the UK, in way in excess of the targets that are set by the European Union. And in actual fact, SMEs in Scotland have got a higher percentage of 100% of public sector contracts and their share of turnover in the whole economy. So that is it. That's a positive. It's something that we've managed to deliver on over recent years. It's something we keep a focus on because we recognise how important it is. Now, the other aspect of that is about the innovation side of it. And again, it's something I'm very, you know, and we've done a lot of good work there, but more to do. And that's about making sure that Scottish businesses that come forward with innovative products are able to be able to present those and get a market for those in the public sector in Scotland, leveraging our £13 billion of procurement spend, be that in the health sector, be it with digital solutions, be it elsewhere. The work of CivTech there has been phenomenal, and we've significantly upscaled their capacity to do that, and that is an international exemplar of how to do it, and they're leading a lot of international work in that regard now to show people how you do this stuff. They've done that primarily on digital and tech, but we're expanding their capability to do that much more broadly. We've got the work of SHIP, the Scottish Health Innovation Partnership, but again looking at innovative solutions coming from Scottish business, normally SMEs, and how we give them market opportunities in the NHS and are more flexible on the purchasing requirements and specifications, so that something that's innovative and maybe doesn't fit exactly in the box of what we're looking for in terms of purchasing requirements, there's a route to market for that. And the supply chain development programmes are again focused on where do we have significant public sector spend, where do we have the opportunity to build indigenous strong supply chains, and how do we put both of those together be able to make that happen. This isn't flick a switch and stuff happens. It's a huge amount of detailed work with different sectors and different businesses and different opportunities, navigating through the rules that are there and making sure we're focused on delivering what we can. We are making progress, but absolutely there's more to do, and I'm always delighted to talk to businesses that have got innovative products and services to understand how working with them we can give them a foothold in the Scottish public sector procurement.
Minister, it wasn't a leading question, it was outlining the concerns that the committee have heard.
Absolutely, and I accept that. And as I said, I'm hugely engaged and very keen to talk to businesses to see how we can help them on that further.
But there was a clear view came across in the evidence that the extent to which supply chains are covered by the process of determining a contract, it simply doesn't go far enough. And in fact, changes in recent years to the process has actually driven many of the problems. So, for example, if a local council was building a new school, it's now a very centralised process. You know, I know when I was a councillor, we awarded a contract direct as a council. Now, for example, in Dumfries and Galloway, it goes through the Hub South West process, notwithstanding all the accountability issues that causes when something goes wrong. It does mean that there's a real emphasis on economies of scale, on big, large contracts. And often what happens is that the use of local supply chains is simply relying on the big contractor to subcontract that work at their discretion. So surely the actual process that we've been driving in recent years has actually caused an increase in large contracts, driven, I suppose, given the fact that we have seen budgets cut to councils. But surely that's still a big part of it, big contracts driven by price.
Well, the whole construction sector works like that. So I don't think there's anything specifically different about public sector procurement in that regard. And clearly you've got to be able to understand what the market price is if we're spending public money. So that's got to be done in as efficiently as possible. But there are very practical things we can and do there to break up large contract sizes into smaller buckets, look for opportunities to do that where it allows, as you said, something very supportive of is allowing smaller businesses to be able to bid for and win smaller pieces of work rather than facing into bigger contracts that make it difficult for them. There's other things we can do and we're very supportive of, which is smaller businesses working together to be able to address some of these larger contracts where we can't break it up into smaller chunks and be able to put forward the bidding proposals there. So again, I think we're agreed on where we want to get to. It's a question of working through the details of that. It's not that we are saying price, 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 far from it. And as I said, we've moved very much away from that. And as I said, I'm very keen to work with businesses to look for opportunities where we can move further in that direction.
So, do you accept, though, that there has been an increase in large contracts, small number of big construction firms winning all these big contracts? But you know, so is there an active piece of work? Because I'm not clear from what you say, apart from its ongoing work. But is there now an active piece of work about, say, adapting the lotting system? A real focus on that to ensure that smaller local suppliers are not driven out, and also you know, actually taking into account the environmental impact when it does come to the criteria. So we know that, you know, I always joke that the biggest growing business in Dumfries is the guy who sells bacon rolls in the outskirts of the town, because he serves all the white vans travelling from Glasgow to Dumfries every day to carry out the work. There's a clear environmental cost of big businesses in the Central Belt carrying out contracts elsewhere. Surely that environmental impact of a lot of this, with a focus on local businesses, should be a bigger proportion of the criteria for awarding contracts, and you should be breaking up the lotting system a lot more to focus on smaller contracts.
Yeah, well, first of all, in terms of has there been a shift in more of this stuff is happening with larger contractors, I don't have the evidence to hand to say if that's accurate or not, but what I can do is say, if you look at the whole piece, as I've said earlier, portion of contracts that go to SMEs in Scotland is far in excess of what it is in the rest of the UK, or in far in excess of the European targets for this. And SMEs get a higher percentage of their work through public sector procurement than larger businesses do. So that's the situation. That's the reality of where the numbers are. That number, from memory, is like about 46.5% or 47%. So that is. That's the reality. Now, you'll always get anecdotal stuff about this happens and that happens on a particular contract, and of course, I'm always keen to see those specific examples, because it helps to inform the overall picture. But the data is clear. We do much more of our procurement through SMEs, and increasingly so in Scotland than elsewhere. There is, as I said already, requirements in place so that the purchasing isn't done on price alone. There are a whole range of other factors, including local benefits, including quality, including sustainability, that are factored into that. We can have a debate about whether that balance is right or not, but again, this isn't black and white. Those factors are already in play and are part of the criteria. And in terms of lot sizes, again, absolutely, we look for every opportunity, as I've said, to break those lots up into smaller buckets, precisely to allow smaller businesses to be able to bid for them. So again, that is a proactive part of what we are doing, have done, has been going on. Sustainable procurement legislation is in place and has been for a number of years. The annual report comes out every year, which is very transparent about what we're doing, how we're doing it, who we're working with, what's happening right across the public sector on this. And the data is moving in the right direction, as I said, because if you look at the proportion of SMEs that are winning those contracts. So everything is, we've got the intent, we've got the actions, we've got the results. Yes, is there more we can do? Absolutely. Are there anecdotal examples of things that can be improved? Of course, there always will be, but we're very keen to address all of that and continue to move in that direction.
One final point, though. You say it's contained in the criteria, but one of the biggest criticisms of the Scotland leasing process is that the actual local supply chains wasn't part of the criteria. So, okay, companies had to have development plans, and we'll see what they actually look like at some point. But the big criticism from trade unions and many others was that specifically having local supply chains was not part of the scoring process when it came to awarding these contracts or these leases.
You'll be aware that there are international rules around about this stuff. There are bidding rules, there are WTO, part of the GPA. We can't just go making this stuff up. We've done as much as we can within those rules to be able to move that forward. Huge commitment on making sure those supply chain development statements were in place to make sure that bidders were coming forward and being very, very clear about how they would use supply chains and scoring criteria. As I said, we've pushed that absolutely to the limit in terms of what has been able to done within international rules, as I'm sure callers are aware.
Thank you. I'll make some progress now. Thank you. Michelle Thompson to be followed by Fiona Hislop.
Good morning, Minister. I want to pick up a little bit further on procurement as well, but just for the record, the finance report was mentioned earlier. I'm on the Finance Committee, and the Scottish Fiscal Commission expects the Scottish Labour participation rate to decline by around 0.2 points per year relative to the rest of the UK, so it's actually even less than you had suggested in when you were talking about it earlier. So going back to my point about procurement, there's a couple of questions here. One, some businesses have asked about the possibility of more pipeline visibility. And I think you've alluded to that earlier, that many businesses will create a kind of component product offering to make the bid, and that would give them time to do that. And my second question is around the use of mandation to, one, helps develop supply chains, and also to target more for net zero. And we saw that comments from that in the Construction Scotland Innovation Centre. So those couple of areas, thank you.
Yeah, the pipeline piece is hugely important, and construction sector's made great progress there. I co-chair the Construction Leadership Forum. It's been a huge area of focus there. The Scottish Futures Trust have been working very hard on this with government, and we've got that pipeline in place now, which allows public sector to put their future plans for construction work on the pipeline tool, and then everybody can have a look and see what's coming up. So that stability of demand is obviously very important in the construction sector, so that contractors know what work is there, and they can plan accordingly, and the whole sector isn't getting moved up and down year on year by the feast and famine in terms of the work that's there. So that's been really effective. It's just come online in the last few months. I think that's making a huge difference. And also working with other industry leadership groups, other groups are looking, other sectors are looking at what construction has done there and learning from it and seeing how they can do something similar. So I think that's a great another example of initiatives we're taking there. And your other point, I think, was around about sustainability, yeah?
Yeah, Saha, you've accurately depicted the wider environment in terms of rules. You mentioned WTO and so on, yeah. But it's a general concept about mandation to affect change in the market. And I'd mentioned net zero as well to use mandation.
Yeah, we can put in place requirements within the rules, as I've said, as best we can, to be able to say that you have to factor in sustainability, net zero aspects, carbon footprint, and so on and so forth. And obviously, we'll look to do that where we can. And that's increasingly an area of focus, as you would imagine, to be able to address it. What does that do? It obviously encourages local production, but also encourages innovation and construction. Prime example, the work with Construction Innovation Centre for innovative solutions to the net zero carbon challenges to come forward. We want to use the levers of public sector procurement to be able to facilitate that as best we can.
Thank you, convener.
Thank you. Fiona Hislop to be followed by Jamie Hagwood-John.
Thank you. I'd like to pursue this a bit more. In terms of supply chain development, it brings resilience but also opportunity. And in terms of the government's activity, can you maybe share with the committee how much of a step change you think there is across the public sector to embed the importance of supply chain development across different departments, not just your own? So, for example, in the NHS, can you share more of what is happening in terms of supporting supply chain development in the NHS? And also, not just public sector, but where there may be private sector opportunities, for example, in net zero around heat pumps. To what extent is that there? And do you really think our agencies as well are geared up to keep a focus, a lead-like focus on supply chain development?
And again, it's something from a manufacturing background, I'm hugely focused on this. We've done a lot of work off the back of the success on PPE manufacturing, and it was great to see that was referenced several times in your earlier evidence sessions, to formalise that process and understand where else we could apply it. Now, there's two parts to that. There's the procurement piece, and I've got responsibility for procurement, so we're working with different through procurement, Scottish Government, reaching out across the whole of that £13 billion spend, which includes local government, it includes Transport Scotland, it includes the NHS, it includes other the public sector bodies to stress the importance of that. As I said, the SHIP work in the health service, the Scottish Health Innovation Partnership work, is a key part of that, and that's increasingly drawing through those opportunities. The other side of it is from the enterprise agencies, and yes, they are hugely seized and focused of the importance of this and working very hard on it. They were an absolutely critical part of the work we did on PPE, and it's about joining this up. So when you look at a sector and you say, right, public sector spending whatever £100 million on this, most of it's going abroad, but let's look at that. Well, we're spending it on these commodities. What businesses do we have in Scotland that are capable of stepping in and doing that? What do they need to be able to allow them to bid? Is it to do with getting their the qualifications and the right standards in place? Is it a question of capacity? Is it a question of skills? Is it a question of investment in equipment or investment in premises? Is it logistics? What is it? What are the things that are stopping them get there? And then the enterprise agencies wheel in and say, right, we can help you with this, we can help you with that. SDS will come in and help with whatever skills or whatever. So it's about getting those suppliers in a place where they're able to bid for those contracts, and not just one supplier, but a whole series of them round about the sector, and creating that capacity and capability to bid for those contracts. So joining that up in an intelligent way is what's important, and to do that, you've got to drill down to understand where you're trying to operate. So the programmes we've got in train at the moment, obviously PPE, we're looking at reshoring of generic medicine manufacturing. We have programmes on heat pump manufacture. Again, there's a couple of opportunities there in Scotland. We need more, but a lot of that then becomes who are the sub-suppliers who supply into the heat pump manufacturers in Scotland, and how do we get more of that content in Scotland. We're looking at electrolysers for hydrogen, which is clearly going to be a huge issue going forward. We're looking at, as I mentioned earlier, timber frame construction from forestry all the way through sawmills into manufacturing facilities in Scotland, and construction sites, and how much of that is going to be off-site manufacture and modular build for the construction sector. So there's about 7 or 8 programmes we're running with that at the moment, and on top of that, obviously, Scotland stuff. And just to clarify on the Scotland thing, there's actually requirements in the contract that if the developer doesn't follow through on the supply chain development plans, use local content, then there are penalties as a consequence of that. So it does have teeth, contrary to what maybe was suggested earlier. So I could talk about this for hours because it's hugely important. I'm hugely passionate about it, and there's a huge amount going on, but I'll stop there given time.
Yeah, I know it's virtual, but I can feel your passion there. Can I maybe reflect that when we started looking at this inquiry, there were real constraints around supermarkets and food supply. So I'd be appreciate your current kind of take and where you think things are in relation to resilience for food supply. Also on the issue, you talked about carbon miles and whether and what powers we have within Scotland to make that part of any public sector contracts, etc. But obviously globally there's movements in that way, but that would have implications for food and drink in particular. So I'm interested in that. And also, thank you for your paper on construction. Cement has come up a number of times, and obviously the enormous amount of energy that's required for cement production has implications for net zero, so innovation would be needed. But we also know from the construction constraints of the supply chain over the recent year, that also is a reason to have that resilience there. So perhaps you can talk about those products, food and drink, cement, and you've already mentioned timber, but if there's anything additional on that.
Yeah, cement, green cement, there you go. Yes, it can be done. Yes, it involves huge capital investment in the plant to do it. Yes, we are talking to Scotland's only cement manufacturing plant about their plans in that regard. Yes, it's very much on the radar. It's part of the mix in construction, as I say. Timber and Massalam timber solutions that allow you to have timber products that can do structurally the job of cement is an important part of that as well. So we're approaching this from a whole range of different aspects. In the construction centre, the Construction Scotland Innovation Centre down in Blantyre are doing a super job leading on this stuff with input from Heriot-Watt University and others. So again, that is a key strand in the Construction Leadership Forum. So we're absolutely on that. As I said, what it will require is significant private sector investment to deliver on that, but the sector understands absolutely that's the direction of travel, and we want to make it as easy as possible for people to make those decisions to invest in that capacity in Scotland for green cement as opposed to elsewhere. Food supply is another great example, and again, there's a lot of different things happening there. had these conversations with local authority purchasing and others, very often this comes down to a willingness to be able to buy, a keenness to buy locally, but the capacity isn't in place locally because of the volumes we're talking about. But that's about, as I said earlier, getting local suppliers to the position where they're able to supply at a scale to meet the procurement requirements, and doing a lot of work to try and join that up as best we can. The food miles part of that is absolutely an important criteria. It's about how you address and factor that into the procurement decisions. But also, as you said, there are moves afoot internationally on carbon accounting and other measures at EU level and elsewhere to take those factors into account. That again, of course, will impact on the cement discussion we've just had. So there's a lot of things happening internationally, and a lot of things that we are moving forward on there to take advantage of those. And I know that some of the evidence you took was in the food and drink sector and some of their examples of difficulties at access and procurement for various reasons, and that's something I've got officials following up on to learn how we learn from those examples to be able to make our processes more effective to deliver on what we all want to see.
And I'll just pass back to the convener shortly. Can you maybe give us an assessment as to where you think the constraints for supply, inward supply of food is to Scotland, bearing in mind Brexit and also COVID kind of constraints? What's your current take and the government's current take?
Yeah, it's obviously hugely concerning that we've got those additional constraints in place that are unhelpful, at least now. As you've heard from wholesalers and retailers, they've worked hard to mitigate those and kept the shelves fully stocked. So I think in terms of that side of it, has the sector and the industry done what it can to keep product flowing? Yes, of course, absolutely they have. And we've worked with them beyond HGV driver issues and elsewhere to help support that. Is there a resilience issue longer term? Yes, there is. Is there more we can do to grow more food in Scotland to support that? Yes, there is. And some of the technology, their vertical farming technology, for example, where Scotland is a world leader in the technology and exporting that technology at scale is an area of opportunity for us. So again, joining all of that up to be able to build more resilience in the Scottish supply chains is something we're very focused on.
Thank you. Back to the convener.
Thank you. And I have Jamie Halko-Johnson to be followed by Gordon McDonald.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the Minister. I've got two quick questions on transport in relation to supply chains and then one on Freeport. So you mentioned at the beginning remote communities being at the end of the supply chains. Do you recognise that good transport links are vital to supporting access to markets for businesses in these areas, and also that the issues facing our ferries fleet with ageing and increasingly unreliable vessels and increased break are causing real concerns for businesses in some of these communities, and also that there is a fear that these problems are only going to get worse over the next few years?
Yes, of course, transport and connectivity is hugely important. We have, obviously, the government's published their strategic transport review identifying the steps we're taking there, and it's important that all of that is addressed and we continue to improve transport links, be that road, rail, ferries, as has been mentioned, and I've no doubt that the new Transport Minister will already be all over this.
Thank you very much. Apologies.
On you go.
Minister. Okay. Jamie, if you would like, I think the minute we've lost the Minister's connection for a second there, but if the Minister's finished, I'll move back to Jamie Halko-Johnson to continue questions.
Sorry about that. Okay. The Minister mentions a review. There are improvements needed to road infrastructure across the Highlands and Islands, my region, across Scotland. Given the opposition of the SNP's new partners in coalition, the Greens, the new road project and waning commitments over the A9 and the A96, how confident can businesses and communities be that the Scottish Government will take forward vital investment in our roads infrastructure, investment that's so important for ensuring supply routes to some of our remote areas?
That balance is hugely important, but business can rest assured that we are absolutely focused on transport connectivity, and where that requires roads to be upgraded, then that will happen. The agreement with the Greens has been structured in a way that allows allows that to happen, taking account of the absolute imperative to move towards reducing car miles and facilitating modal shift in transport, but business connectivity is as business minister, I'm hugely focused on making sure that that continues to happen.
Okay, thank you. I'm just wondering, Minister, can you provide any update on the green port proposals? What's the timeline to designation and implementation? Will there be any further talks with the UK government about alignment with the Freeport's proposals? And given it's reported that the UK funding available will allow for only one green port as opposed to two Freeports, what impact will that decision by the Scottish Government to go forward with the green ports model have on their ability to support wider development of port infrastructure?
Yeah, quite a lot in that, but I'll take this opportunity to give yourself and the committee an update on where we are. As you know, the UK government's Freeport proposals came out, well, more than a year ago now. We looked at them at that point and decided that there were some fundamental gaps there that we couldn't sign up to. We weren't going to engage in a race to the bottom, as I'm sure the committee would appreciate, on standards, environmental standards, labour standards, labour pay rates, etc. And we were absolutely seized of the requirement to make sure there was a net zero component central to this initiative. We discussed that with UK government through the course of last year. In September, they came back and said that they were not under no circumstances would they allow us to make a payment of the real living wage a requirement, and they were very lukewarm on the net zero requirements as well. As a consequence of that, the discussion stopped. We then signalled that we were keen to move forward with our own proposals. We're now in a position, I can let you know, where UK government have come back to us and said that they wanted to reopen discussions. Those discussions are ongoing at the moment. We had hoped to have them concluded earlier, before the end of the year, which is when we said we would go forward with our proposals. But clearly, given those discussions are ongoing and are reaching conclusion, it's important that we see that process through to conclusion before we see next steps. So we are hopeful that we will make progress here. We are hopeful that the solution will come forward, and that will be a solution that will have our requirements on net zero and fair work at its core, and it will be a solution that will be good for Scottish businesses, the Scottish economy, Scottish workers and communities, and the environment.
Thanks very much, Minister. Just very quickly on that point, then. You can't give us a timeline exactly, but once those discussions have concluded and once that information is available, you'll be able to update this committee and Parliament.
Absolutely, that will happen as soon as we can. And you're right, there's two partners in this. We have been keen for more than a year to make progress on this. We are not. We are not the ones that's taking the time to get our ducks in a row. We are waiting for our partner to finalise the things that they need to finalise internally. As you understand, they're slightly distracted by other matters at the moment.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. And now Gordon MacDonald.
Thank you, Convener. And, I just want to continue this discussion about transport in relation to our supply chain inquiry. The Strategic Transport Project Review that you touched upon a minute ago recommends that there should be a modal shift from road freight to rail. And I'm just wondering if you could tell us what steps the Scottish Government are taking to support and encourage that modal shift from road to rail.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of that will come down to the specific opportunities that present themselves. So having discussions, I'm not close to the details, transport colleagues working on this. But where they present themselves, we'll look at where railhead facilities can be developed to allow more product to go onto rail rather than road. Clearly, a lot of that will be where there is volume products and you've got specific opportunities to be able to say, yeah, we can take X hundred or whatever it is, trucks off the road and by facilitating some rail connection or something. So that work's ongoing. Piece of work that I am directly involved in, which is supportive of that, is looking at direct port shipments from Scotland. They've convened a group of port operators and airports and others to understand what volume of traffic leaves Scotland by truck going to ports in the south of England, and how do we address opportunities to get more of that on ships leaving Scottish ports. But that's going to be a combination of, there's a commercial realities there, but it's understanding what are those commercial realities and other things that we can do to be able to move the locus of calculation there to make it easier for people to be able to use Scottish ports. So that work's ongoing, and I hope that that will yield some significant results going forward.
I was actually going to ask you about direct ferry routes from Scotland a wee bit earlier, but I'll continue that level of questioning just now. There has been witnesses, as you're aware, called upon a new direct ferry route from Scotland to Europe, you know, similar to what we had to Zeebrugge from Resive previously. And I noticed that Irish hauliers have reduced by 214,000 the number of HGV movements using the Ireland to UK land bridge, and the number of direct ferry routes from Ireland to Europe have increased from less than a dozen before Brexit to 44. So given that the previously thought that routes from Ireland to the continent haven't been financially viable, has the situation in relation to 6-hour delays at Dover, 7-mile tailbacks on M20 refocused Scottish exporters' minds on direct ferry routes from Scotland?
Yeah, I think it's one of these situations where you've got, maybe we wouldn't call it market failure, but you've got a scenario where you've got different players there who are all rightly looking at it from their own perspective. But then when you look at the whole system and get everybody in the room and talk about the different moving parts, you're able to broker solutions that otherwise wouldn't happen. Because clearly, if you're looking to move goods, you can't be messing about with this stuff and taking risks on it because you lose your market. Cost is an issue, reliability is an issue, frequency is an issue, what happens if something goes wrong is an issue. So you can get it on a truck to Dover, there's a ferry every half an hour or whatever, and you can get another truck when you need one, then that, notwithstanding the other capacity constraints we've talked about, you've got flexibility there. If you're looking at a Scottish port and there's one ferry once a week, and if that doesn't happen and you've got to wait another week, then you've got a problem. You've got those kind of issues, so it's multifaceted. It's not just cost. So what we're doing is, as I said, looking at commodities where that can be done, looking at routes where it makes sense, looking at what the actual cost gap is and whether it's bridgeable, looking at is there resilience we can build in. I think if you've got all of those things kind of move forward a couple of notches, we could perhaps be in a position where operators and businesses all look at it and say, you know what, that's something I could be part of, consolidating loads, for example, amongst different producers, etc. So all of that's on the table, and I think that hopefully we'll make some progress on that. But now the environment we're in the Irish example, really gives fresh impetus.
And just getting back to the rail situation, and I accept that you're not the Transport Minister, but we've recently saw the UK government and HS2, the extent of the route being reduced, and it seems to have become nothing more than a London to Birmingham shuttle. And given that the justification for HS2 was to free up capacity on the existing network for local trains and more freight, does that have an impact on Scottish exporters who were looking to use rail freight, given the example of the large supermarket who has introduced trains from Spain to Scotland with fresh produce, which has helped its supply chain resilience? I'm just wondering what impact you think HS2 restrictions on its route has had on the ability to move freight onto rail.
Yeah, I mean, it's obviously, you characterised it very well, and clearly the timescales there are, HS2 is only just kind of getting started, so it's not impacting things today, but does it impact strategic thinking for the future? Yeah, of course it does. High-speed rail is hugely important, and you look at international examples where it's well embedded in the transport infrastructure. Yes, we should be in a position to exploit and develop that more. The speed's an issue, frankly, that the capacity is probably more of an issue, and it was going to help in that regard. So the fact that that's as we said at the start, they're going to do this seriously. They would have started from both ends at once. They would have started from Scotland and from London and met in the middle. But clearly, that's not what it's all about. It's about getting consumers into London, commuters into London, rather than looking at the whole country. Yeah, it's an issue, but I say it's a more of a long-term issue, affects strategic thinking, but in the immediate term, there's other things that we can and are do to address this issue.
Okay, thanks very much, Convener.
Thank you. Thank you for your time this morning, Minister. When we first began the inquiry, I think it did come from concerns, particularly before Christmas, around we'd heard from construction sector and food and drink sector about pressures. There's perhaps less media reporting of concerns around shortages. That might be because other things are occupying the media at the moment. I did notice in the construction supply chain document you sent us, at the very end it said the general expectation in the marketplace that the situation will now begin to settle, at least in terms of supply. Is that something that's particularly relevant to construction? Is that something you see across the Scottish economy? I suppose that's more focused on commodity than people in places. Well, I suppose we're looking for some assurances that while things maybe are starting to settle compared to the pressure we saw before Christmas, that this is still a priority for government, that we recognise whether it's Brexit or the pandemic or other factors, does give an opportunity to change the way we do business in Scotland. Part of that is through pressures we're experiencing, but it does maybe present an opportunity for us to look at some of the issues members have raised around shorter supply chains, more resilient supply chains. So I suppose the question is, you know, do we still have a, and I think you've expressed it this morning, but can we have a commitment that those are still important issues for the government and that the 10-year economic strategy will reflect and give a, you know, a recognition in the importance of how we look at future supply chain?
Yes, you have that commitment. Yes, you're absolutely right. Resilience is hugely important, and there are other aspects beyond what we've talked about today that are also part of that broader resilience piece. Doing more manufacturing in Scotland, as I said, as an old manufacturing guy, that's hugely close to my heart. So that focus absolutely is central to what we're doing in developing those supply chains and to be able to support Scottish business and consumers absolutely where we can. It's hugely important. The reality, of course, is that businesses will make those decisions to buy where it makes sense for them to buy. All we can do is help to put in place measures that would make that decision easier for them, and I think the real risk, it's interesting, if we look at the PPE situation, the real concern at the start of that, or as we moved through it, was yes, we've managed to switch production to Scotland, but will it all switch back to China as soon as the markets open up again? The reality was that that wasn't the case, and we've managed to hold that position for a whole load of reasons that were about innovation, with AlphaStall we're moving up to transparent masks, which has opened up new markets, and roundabout automation and other factors we've done to facilitate that. So yes, the focus is there, but it's about making those lots and lots of intelligent decisions locally in different supply chains all add up, making a difference. And I think the PPE thing has shown that we can do it. We can do it quickly, and we can hold on to it, and we can use it as a platform for export if we make the right decisions in those sectors.
Thank you very much this morning, Minister, for your time and for the time from your officials, and we will briefly end the meeting before the next set of witnesses.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
The committee will now take evidence on the Registrars of Scotland Digital Registration etc. Regulations 2022. I welcome to the meeting Tom Arthur, who is Minister for Public Finance, Planning and Community Wealth. He's joined by Graham Fisher, Deputy Director of Scottish Government Legal Directorate, and Paddy Murray, Policy Lead at Registrars of Scotland. I invite the Minister to make a short opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to the committee. I'm grateful for the opportunity to appear today to answer questions about this instrument, which relates to land registration. As the committee will appreciate very well, the Keeper of the Register of Scotland plays a vital role in the Scottish economy by safeguarding property rights through the registration of documents in the Land Register and the Register of Sarings. In response to the necessary closure of Register of Scotland's offices due to the COVID pandemic, the Emergency Coronavirus Act provided a basis for applications to be submitted to ROS digitally, ensuring the property market could continue to operate during the period of ongoing public health restrictions. This method of submission has proven enormously popular, with strong stakeholder support for retention of this method of working. The Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Bill, which was introduced yesterday and will be published today, will therefore look to provide a continuing basis for applications to be submitted to ROS digitally. These regulations complement the bill by making digital submissions the default method of submission to ROS, subject to exceptions, and in addition, open up the Register of Deeds in the books of Council in Session to electronic documents for the first time. The regulations also make technical amendments to the Requirements of Writing Scotland Act 1995, clarify and make additional provision about issues that have come to light through the increased use of electronic documents and signatures over the last 2 years. These regulations give effect to proposals set out in the digital submission consultation Registers of Scotland held on our behalf, to set out plans on how digital submission could be placed on a permanent statutory footing for several of the Keeper's registers, and how this represents a positive step on the road to fully digital registration. The reaction to that consultation was overwhelmingly positive, with customers and stakeholders showing strong support for the proposals. There is a clear expectation within the conveyancing profession that digital submission should become the standard method of submitting applications to ROS. As the convener will be aware, I am joined today by Harry Murray from Register of Scotland and Graham Fisher from the Scottish Government Legal Directorate. I would be happy, along with my officials, to answer any questions that the committee may have. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. Could I maybe first of all ask, I was wondering why the regulations have been drafted in a way that they only come into force, that's in respect of the presumption, if new primary legislation successfully replaces the Emergency Acts. Could maybe, I don't know if Harry Murray might like to explain why it's been brought forward in that order and what the reason for that is.
Yes,
would the Minister be satisfied with Harry Murray?
I'm very happy for Harry to respond to your question, Convener.
Obviously the bill and the interaction with the secondary is obviously ultimately a matter for Parliament, but actually specifically on the technicalities of how they interact, and on this specific point, I think actually Mr Fisher from SGLD is better positioned to respond.
Thank you. Mr Fisher, would you like to? It's just to understand why it only comes into force if the new primary legislation successfully replaces. Is it expected that it will replace? I was wondering why you said if it replaces.
Certainly happy to reply, Convener. Yes, I mean obviously it's for Parliament to consider the bill provisions, and appreciate those have only been introduced yesterday, as the Minister said, and published today. But effectively, what the COVID Recovery and Reform Bill provisions will do is just replace the temporary provisions which were in place to allow traditional paper deeds which have been signed to be registered electronically, and copies of those deeds be registered electronically at the register, and it will replace the temporary provisions in pretty much identical terms to the existing provisions in the temporary Coronavirus Scotland Act 2020 provisions, which allow for digital submission. Now, because the changes that are being made in regulations 2 and 3 of these regulations come in be intended to be in effect at the same time as the permanent provisions which would be introduced by the bill, it was thought appropriate to make the procedural changes that these regulations make alongside the change in the bill that's come forward, so they have effect at the same time, which makes sense just in having both sets of measures in place at the same time. So that's the only reason for the fact that the change is being made alongside the bill, and just so that they can come into effect at the same time, which is, you know, is the neatest approach for having the default provision that's made in these regulations, and as the Minister's mentioned, which have been supported by the conveyancing profession, and to have that all come into force at the same time. So that, I hope that answers the question, but I'm happy obviously to answer if that doesn't make sense. It's Section 24 of the new bill, if members are interested, which has the provision which just simply replaces the temporary provision in the Coronavirus Act.
Okay, thank you. I'll now bring in Michelle Thompson to follow by Alexander Burnett.
Good morning, Minister. Thank you for coming along this morning. I'm personally very happy to see this progress, and it's one of the good aspects of COVID that it's accelerated something that was intended anyway. It's a very generic question I've got, actually, in terms of how confident are you that the organisational capacity and capability from an IT perspective is in place, and with particular reference to, and you may already have tested that, the safety and security, because obviously these are extremely important documents that go back a long way, and hacking is a concern for any organisation. So it's fairly general. Thank you.
Can I thank Michelle Thompson for that question, and also thank her support for these measures, and recognise that this is an opportunity to take another step forward to a fully digital service. I'll maybe ask Harry Murray to come in a moment, but the observation I would make is that this is actually putting on a permanent footing what has been in place for the last couple of years with the digital submission service. And as you'll be aware from the consultation response, the consultation that was carried out from December 2020 to February of last year, there has been overwhelming stakeholder support. And encourage members who have an interest in the applications of digital technology to public services to read the responses to the consultation, which are really encouraging and heartening, just how overwhelming the support has been. A whole range of particular issues, from efficiency, ease of use, and huge savings as well in postal costs, and indeed in paper, which is something, given our environmental commitments, I'm sure we would all welcome further. But with regards to seeking assurance about the capacity to deliver going forward, I'm going to ask, if your permission, Convener Harry Murray, just to expand upon the points that I've made.
Yes, please go ahead, Mr. Murray.
Yeah. I mean, really, just exactly building on what the Minister said there. I mean, I think the key point to make is the development and the implementation costs and the work to provide for these regulations. That's already been done. That work was carried out at the outset of the pandemic to make use of the provisions that were introduced in the temporary legislation. I think on the point of security and fraud, I think the important point to make is the digital submission service. It's only open to existing Registers of Scotland e-service account holders, the majority of whom are solicitors, and those users are applicants. They're under a statutory duty of care under the underpinning land registration legislation 2012 Land Registration Scotland Act. So, and solicitors are obviously also additionally under their own professional and regulatory standards. Today, there's been in the two years that we've been offering these services, no fraud has been attributable to the digital submission service. So we're extremely confident, as our users, that this doesn't expose any risk and that there are any issues, as I say, because we are effectively, this is the business as usual operating model now. So we're not in essence introducing anything new.
Okay, thank you, convener.
Thank you. Jamie Hulk, sorry, Alexander Burnett, to be followed by Jamie Hulk-Johnson.
Thank you very much, convener. I know my register of interest around using the land registry and certainly welcome the progress in digitisation and electronic formats being developed. I just wonder, can the minister just expand a bit on people who are still going to need to, or still only capable of submitting written or paperwork to the register? We have a huge issue, particularly in rural areas, with a digital divide, people's connections and the like. I just want to firstly expand on guarantee that people, explain to people how people can still submit non-electronically, and for those who are submitting non-electronically, can he explain how this will be recorded and reported to make sure there's no discrimination in the quality of service or speed of service between those doing it digitally and those doing it non-digitally? Thank you.
Thank Mr. Vermette for his question, and it's an important one. As you'll be aware, while this does move to a digital by default, there are exemptions within the regulations. So, for example, where the Registers of Scotland IT system would be down for a period of more than 48 hours, paper applications would be possible. Similarly, and particularly in relation to the important point that Mr. Burnett raises, for those individuals who don't have access to a computer or an internet connection, the option of paper submission will again still be available. And there is also a discretionary power for the convener to allow for paper submissions in exceptional circumstances. But again, I would be happy if you perhaps bring in Harry Murray, who can perhaps expand on some of these points.
Again, just building on what the minister says, the digital submission service, as I'd explained previously, is limited to existing professional users, primarily members of the legal and conveyancing community. But we have already existing, and they will continue to be provided these exceptions, which apply. The key one being obviously a citizen who was dealing with their own conveyancing activity. They would simply be able to submit a traditional paper-based application in the way that they previously would have. The way that the land registration provisions work, there's no preference afforded to a digital application. The date of registration will be the date of registration, so there's no real change there. The other point I think that was that there was a query around was island communities. The digital provisions themselves lend themselves really well to this. Effectively, what we have is that a system that introduces a level playing field, so that remote or island communities, for example, they're no longer disproportionately impacted by the vagaries of postal or courier or ferry or services. So we feel that this certainly introduces a level playing field for all manner of people interacting with our services.
Can I just come back, sorry, on the second part of my question and press you for what analysis will we be able to see in the reporting of the volume electronically and by written submissions? And appreciating this, you're saying there'll be no discrimination in terms of dates, but will we be able to actually see volumes?
Yeah, I mean the keeper frequently provides statistical analysis from all of the full range of work that she provides, and certainly if this was something that the committee were interested in having periodic feedback on, I cannot see there being any difficulties there. It's something that the keeper could potentially provide as part of her quarterly updates to the committee, something of that nature. But I wouldn't see any difficulties in us being able to provide the data, which I think will just go to confirm that there is no disadvantage to these types of submissions.
Thank you. I hope the keeper will be noting this conversation then. Thank you very much, convener.
Thank you. Jamie Harcourt-Johnson, you have a question.
I do. Thanks very much, convener. The questions, I had a couple of questions. One, I think, has really been covered by the last a bit there from Alex. And I'm delighted, as Harry Murray says, if there's any disadvantages that island communities face, has been removed as an islander myself. I was just going to ask the minister very quickly. There was 223 respondents, 97% approval rating for this, which is something that politicians could only dream of. But obviously, there were some concerns raised, or there may have been some concerns raised. Could you outline any of the issues that might have been raised around this these changes?
Can I thank Mr. Harcourt-Johnson for this question? I agree entirely. It was overwhelming, near unanimous support. The small proportion of respondents, I think less than 10%, who raised questions, I think it was primarily with regard to a digital by default approach and any of the potential consequences that could arise from that, people being excluded. But the sort of previous line of question, I think, goes to show how that issue has been addressed with the regard that there were safeguards built in. There were also some very sort of limited number of concerns raised around security of personal data. But again, as has been touched on earlier, that has is addressed in the sense that there's no new personal data being collected through this process. I think, as we've already seen over the last 2 years, this is a robust and resilient service which has served us well throughout the pandemic, and indeed, as well as providing a more efficient service going forward, it also will provide us with a more resilient service going forward should any other, hopefully not, but any other unforeseen events require the kind of interventions that we've been living with over the past 2 years. But I don't know if there's anything perhaps that Harry Murray would like to add from my ROS perspective.
Yeah, just I mean, really, just exactly as the minister said there. I mean, I certainly personally have never been involved in any form of public consultation that's actually had such striking support. I mean, it was almost we were having to dig to find anything. I mean, it's slightly anecdotal, but I think of the responses that we had, the sole respondent who objected to the placing of the digital submission provisions on a permanent footing, the rest of the responses would tend to suggest that they actually answered that question in error. The other point I think that's worth calling out is the very small number of people who had what could be classed as negative responses, that there was nothing in the way of any positive contribution as to or any specific comments as to why they weren't. So it was really difficult to tackle or tease anything out of that. And the only other thing, sorry, to add as well is obviously the managing of personal data and maintaining public records, that is the quintessentially the work of the keeper. It's something that she has enormous experience in. So it's something that we are very confident. We have robust processes in place, consistently doing impact assessments and reviewing our processes and making sure that we maintain our records to the highest possible standards. So we're extremely confident that we don't expose anyone to any risks.
Okay, thank you to you both for those answers. Thanks, convener.
Thank you. So if there's no further questions from members, we'll now move to agenda item 4, which is the formal debate on the motion. I remind the committee that only members and the minister may take part in the formal debate. I invite the minister to speak if there's anything further he would like to say and to move the motion.
Only to formally move the motion, convener. Thank you.
Thank you. Do any members wish to speak in the debate on the motion? And if you do, please type an R in the chat box. Nope, I think members were content with the question and answer session. I will now put the question on the motion. The question is that motion S6M02599 be approved. Are we all agreed? Yes, I think everybody is happy with that, so thank you. We are agreed. The motion is therefore approved. I invite the committee to agree that the clerk and I will produce a short factual report of the committee's decisions and arrange for it to have it published. And I thank the Minister and his officials for joining us today. We will now move into private session for the remaining items on the agenda. Oh, apologies. No, we don't. Sorry, that was my haste. So we have another SSI. We'll now move to agenda item 5, which is consideration of a further SSI. The committee is invited to note the Consumer Scotland Designated Regulators Regulations 2021. The purpose of this instrument set out the authorities as per section 9.6 of the Consumer Scotland Act 2020, who are designated as regulators from whom Consumer Scotland can require information related to its functions. I invite members to note the instrument. So that does now conclude the public part of this morning's meeting. I suspend the meeting and move to private session.